Amen and amen. It has been said that character is the foundation for all real success. It has been said that character is the foundation of all real success. So that goes to show you, like, we can easily judge, again, as I mentioned last week, we can judge a book by its cover and say, well, look at him, he's wearing a suit. Are you hearing me? Or, wow, this guy is so polite, and little do you know, he like beats his wife at night. Are you hearing me? There's no way you would know by mere appearance. But God, again, knows exactly what's going on at all times. The reason I'm stressing that and emphasizing that is, let that be a marker to you in your life that everything you do is not merely being watched as if someone's stalking you, but that God, if you're his kid, he's desiring to see it come out and see what you do about it. Are you hearing me? He gives you certain situations and circumstances for a purpose and reason. We learned that last week. And it's sad that it takes bad things to happen for, again, things to really come to the surface. A person literally may have all the money in the world, all the fanciest clothes and all of that, but without character, without good character, he will never be or she will never be truly successful. True success is when God looks at you and says, I'm pleased with you. That's true success. When God looks at you and says, I'm pleased with you. I love when my wife tells me, oh, you're awesome, you're this, that, and the other. You're the most amazing man in the universe. I will love you all of my days. With all of my gaze, I will give you sweetness like a sun ray. You are greater than a Hyundai. Are you hearing me? She just goes on. However, that's not my goal in life, for my wife to look to me or anything like that. That's not my goal when somebody gives me compliments. That's not my goal in life. Wow, this is great. I want to hear God say, come on in.
Yes.
Come on into my kingdom, my good and faithful servant. Yes. I do know who you are.
Thank you.
You knew me, but I knew you. But so often we live to please people. We live in the poor sense of pleasing people, not just blessing people. I'm talking about where your whole life's work is based and dependent on one person allowing you to do something or not, or giving you a pat on the back and saying, great. We waste our days trying to please such a person in our life when God desires to work on your character. So your outside doesn't fool God, but it can fool people. And last week I mentioned that today we're going to talk a little bit, very briefly, on what good character and bad character is. I don't have to go in detail because many of you here are adults. You're very competent to see, wait, bad character should and usually be envious. That's what it should usually, I mean, that's what I think it is. Bad character is someone who's envious, who's jealous. I mean, can you name something? Can you shout something at me? What would you say, man? That somebody has a bad character. Name like a trait.
Gossip.
An adjective, huh?
Gossip.
A gossiper.
Yeah.
That's a bad character trait. What else?
Nasty attitude.
A nasty attitude. What else?
A liar.
A liar. Somebody who lies. That's a bad character trait. This sounds like the devil now. Are you hearing me? It's crazy how Jesus pins people in that relationship where you are of your father, the devil. Isn't that wild? I don't know about you, but I don't want my character to look anything like the devil's. Stingy, greedy, malicious, envious, jealous, angry all the time, bitter. Are you hearing me? The devil's the most bitter person if I could ever imagine. The devil is a person embodying a human flesh. Listen, why wouldn't he be the most bitter person? Why do they have this? Why do humans get to get a chance? I thought I ruined it all. Why do humans get a second chance just because they believe? Well, I'm going to make sure that they don't believe, that they don't follow through, that they don't work on their character. I'm going to make sure that they stay as bad as they are in their heart, because then it blinds them from God, because God may potentially never know them through a process that we ourselves avoid. Can someone say sanctification? And I want to read the Bible because I need it. I need the Word of God. I'm so glad we have it. Yes. You know, the early church didn't have the Bible. Did you know that the people in the Bible didn't have the Bible the way that we do? They had the Old Testament. They had a few books here and there. And to be honest, most of them still didn't have that. It was just oratory. It was words. That's all it was. They had to hear it from somebody else. Praise God, we got something in front of us. We got a gift that even people in the Bible, again, did not have.
Yeah.
So we get to see how they all responded and acted and all of that. And again, I don't need to sell the Bible to you, but praise God, take it or leave it. Please take it. Amen. Can you put up on the screen? We're going to read the NIV just because that version is a little more... It's easier to comprehend what's being said here in Psalm 15, 1 through 5. I wanted to get straight to the point without breaking through languages and whatnot tonight. That's not what we're going to do tonight. So I want to put it up, Psalm 15, 1 through 5, the NIV. And look at this. David is a man who was after God's heart. In other words, he wasn't just chasing him. He was literally likened to some type of holiness, some type of blamelessness. But listen to me now, David was by no means perfect. He wasn't perfect. God knew his ending, God knew his middle point in life, God knew his time when he seemed to be the most holiest, where it looks like he was a shepherd boy just doing his own thing. Amen. But David wasn't perfect, yet his character was good. Let's read Psalm 15, 1 through 5. Look what he's writing here. Lord, who can live in your sacred tent? In other words, who can be with you, God? Who can be in your presence? Who can stay on your holy hill? Go on to verse 2. Anyone who lives without blame and does what is right. He speaks the truth from his heart. He doesn't tell lies about others. He doesn't do wrong to his neighbors, those around him, those who work with him. He doesn't say anything bad about them. He hates, look at this, sinful people. We're not supposed to hate. Watch this now. He hates sinful people. He honors those who have respect for the Lord. He keeps his promises even when it hurts. He lends his money without charging too much interest. He doesn't accept money to harm those who aren't guilty. Anyone who lives like that will always be, what's that word?
Secure.
Secure. Now, in looking for verses and studying and realizing that, wait a minute, there's so much the Bible says about character, where do I really begin? I wanted to just zero in on this tonight, because the bad things we're kind of aware of for the most part. It's the good things that we probably have misunderstood or are not walking in to the entirety that we can possibly do that as Christians. And so let's go back to 15:1. And we're going to stay here. There is one more scripture I want to bring in that's at the end. And it's pretty wild that our church service last week was an hour long. It looks like that's how long it'll be tonight as well. But let's see what God does. God, do whatever you want. Amen.
Amen.
Speak to us and move us, Lord God, in Jesus' name. I just want to go back to 15:1, because as we read the Bible, I want you to learn this, and for those of you who don't know this, those of you who do, amen, continue. Those of you who don't, you don't read the Bible as a storybook. It's good to sit and marinate on the Word. Amen? I did an accent, just in case you weren't listening. Praise God. So verse 1 here says, Lord, who can live on your, in your sacred tent? Who can be with you? Who can be on your holy hill? These are the people that can. Go to the verse 2. Verse 2 again. Anyone who lives without blame and does what is right. Number one, like my friend Spike Lee said, do the right thing. Do the right thing. You know, we can justify our actions, but when we have to justify it, that means we're not necessarily doing the right thing. It's okay to justify certain things for certain... I mean, it's very like... There's a fine line there. It's easy to do it. And it's greater to do it when it's righteous and holy to justify your actions and not merely to make up for your mistakes because you are not doing the right thing. Are you hearing me? We can do that all the time. It's very easy to fall into this bad character trait to say, oh, well, the reason I allowed this to happen was because my aunt was in town. And see, when my aunt comes in town, it takes all of my focus and energy. So that's why my dog keeled over. I don't know, whatever story it can be. You name it. Whatever it is, oftentimes if we have to justify a situation by blaming somebody else, we are the ones to blame. Are you hearing me? I mean, what if Jesus blamed others for what was... I mean, he could have. He should have. He should have, but he didn't. He could have demolished those in the temple, not merely just whipped them and flipped tables when they were in his father's house, using it as a den of thieves, or becoming that by their selling and exchanging in the house of God. But he didn't do that. He chilled. He stood back a little bit. He did do a little whooping. That was it. There's many other circumstances I could bring up, but that's what I thought of first because I love that. I love that. But Jesus was so compassionate, you never really see other instances of that anywhere else. But the Father's house, you don't mess with. Amen. You don't mess with the Father's house. You don't mess with the church. Amen. Look how sacred. You see how Jesus, again, this is a tangent, but as we're going through this, it hits me that Jesus was so zealous over his bride, and he still is. He judges us in a special way, and he allows us to judge one another in a righteous way. Yeah. And so anyhow, do the right thing, number one. And then it goes on to say, he speaks, those who essentially come from a place of good standing with God and not righteousness by faith, but in their character, he speaks the truth from his heart, or from her heart, speaks the truth. Now, it's not one of those truths that hurts somebody. Are you hearing me? That's another issue that we have a problem with. Well, I had to tell the truth. It doesn't matter. That's the truth. Do you see how cold? So we can justify telling the truth with this verse and said, well, the Bible says, if I have a good character, I got to tell the truth. And I mean, it was what it was. And you're all crying, or rather the person you're talking to is crying. You hurt their feelings. You went about it in a non-compassionate way. You lacked compassion. You didn't do it in a way that was loving. And of course, you can't always perfectly speak the truth to somebody because everyone responds differently. However, the key here is in the heart, you speak the truth. And God will see how you did it in that regard. So do the right thing, and by telling the truth, you're not being deceptive. A deceptive person is someone who, again, twists the truth or lies so that things can fall better in their on their behalf. And so you don't want to be deceptive. You want to tell the truth. And this sounds foundational and fundamental, but we have all failed in this in every way we can possibly think of, even in small ways. Again, by justifying simple things. Number three, go on to the next verse. He doesn't tell lies about others. He doesn't tell lies about others. I've witnessed people tell lies all my life about people that I know. And what they were saying, obviously, was a lie. But they had some people believe them. The thing about lies is that you can tell a lie to somebody who is undiscerning and they may fall for it. which means the judgment is even greater on you because you're leading somebody astray. There's a reason why we're called to tell the truth. There's a reason why we don't tell lies about others, especially when they're not there and nobody knows them, because you can potentially lead somebody away from the reality of the person or the person in this regard. He doesn't tell lies about others. And I would go on to say, you don't just make stuff up either that you don't know for a fact. Are you hearing me? Because if you speak like you're telling the fact, somebody's going to believe you like you're telling the truth, but you're telling a lie. In other words, if I saw Julio dressed with the nice shoes, and I look at him with his black hat, his black hoodie, a regular burglar in my mind. But watch this. I could easily look at his shoes and say, wow, oh, he got some money. Are you hearing me? He got some nice shoes on. He must have money. Oh, he got that new Suzuki. I don't know, whatever it is. How would I know where he got the shoes or where he got the... He could have been a blessing. Somebody blessed him.
That's right.
He was probably praying for years for some new shoes and somebody blessed him. And I'm looking at Julio and telling Anthony, man, Julio got money. Look at his shoes. Lying about Julio. I'm telling a lie about somebody else that somebody may believe, like Anthony, a third party. Are you hearing me? Do you see how easy it is to fall into this trap of lying without intentionally coming out and lying? Do you see that? How we kind of just want to say black or white, but no, there's a long way to get to lying. There's different routes to lying. That's not good character. That's bad character. And unchecked, ladies and gentlemen, you will remain in the same spiritual place that you've been. Because as we know last week, God uses situations and circumstances to sharpen our character. Bad things, or things that maybe aren't bad, but you can make them bad by how you respond in your heart toward them. So, he doesn't do wrong to his neighbors or people around them. You're not looking for somebody to fall. You're not waiting for it. Are you hearing me? This is bad character when you look for somebody to spiritually fall or to simply be knocked down some pegs, maybe at the workplace or even your family members, you know. Oh, my sister doesn't deserve that. Look at her promotion. She's so sloppy and she's this, that, and the other. Are you hearing me? Do you see? It's very easy to fall into this bad habit. And unchecked, again, we remain in the same place. God doesn't expand our territory. God doesn't give you more because you can only do so much with the little you have. Don't badmouth or try to get back at people. He doesn't say anything bad about them. Amen. Are you hearing this? A good character has this wrapped inside of it, that you do not say anything bad about people. That could mean the president, hallelujah. Are you hearing me? We could list the issues of everyone we know, and they may be factual and correct, but it's not correct for us. Are you hearing me? It's correct. Oh, wait a minute, he did this, he did that. It's clearly there, it's there. She did this, she did that. However, our job is not to point it out and say, you did this and you did that. Isn't that wild? It's not. Now, in the context of church, can you call a brother out and sister out in sin? Yes, you can. The Bible calls you to do that. However, to simply speak bad about somebody is not the same as coming up to a brother or sister and saying, hey, this is what's going on. I saw that. Man, you know what? This is what the word says. That's how I feel. Let's talk about it. And of course, if it's a person of leadership in your life, that's a whole other story. There's a different dynamic that you submitted yourself to say, it's okay, point this stuff out. I need it, Pastor. I need it. Now, you don't badmouth or try to get back at people. You don't say anything bad about them. I could stay on there. I could literally stop now. We just do an altar call. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. I've learned throughout time, you know, you could be zealous for the Lord and still make these mistakes where without you intentionally trying to tarnish somebody. You're just so upset about something that you want to voice it, but it's not your place. And let me give you an example. Let's say somebody's given a large platform and you know how they're living. Are you hearing me? You know how they're living. You know what they've said and done. It's not that they're not perfect or that they should be. It's nothing like that. But there's certain things that you see that you know for a fact. And those things can build something in your heart where you're like, man, God, how could you allow? This is not right. People are being deceived. Still, we have to really understand that if we don't have a place in that person's life to speak to them, let's just speak to God. Are you hearing me? It's not that we speak bad about them no matter what it is. Challenging, right? Having a good character has to be challenged. You've got to be challenged. It's got to be easy for you. The devil's got to do something very easy in front of you. Push somebody in front of your face, you know, that you can easily say something bad about. Now it's up to you. God's looking at you like, hey, you're going to say something bad about it? Because I was just going to bless you with something. And it's not that I want to curse you at all, but I want to take you somewhere else. But I can't, because I can't trust you with this.
Right.
The Bible talks about God as a master who comes back after a long trip.
That's right.
And he gives three servants some things, some talents, money. He gives them things to duplicate and multiply. So he comes back and he checks them. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
So the master's checking on you. The master's checking on us to see what we're doing with what we've got and what's inside of our heart. Before he says, come on in. Before he says, I've given you that land, this mission, this ministry, this whatever it is. Are you hearing me? Okay, next one, verse 4. This is a big one. He hates sinful people. He hates sinful people. Somebody who has good character hates good people. What does that mean? I thought we weren't supposed to talk bad about somebody, so now we got to hate somebody? What does that mean? He honors those who have respect for the Lord. I want to park here, because sometimes, well, let me put it this way. The Bible says bad company corrupts good character or good morals. What does that mean? Some of you have friends that God wanted you to cut off a long time ago. And they could be Christian too. Are you hearing me? The issue and reason being is that these people may have the tendency to rub off on you in a negative way. Now here, sinful people can fall under a number of things. You can be a sinful person if you miss the mark of righteousness. Sin is missing the mark of righteousness. That's what it means. Now, you can easily fall under that umbrella. However, God has called us to not simply sit with sinners for no reason, but to sit with them for a purpose. The problem is, many of us are sitting with people that were probably involved with our old ways, knew our old lifestyle habits, and they have a tendency of defiling what God is working on. The Bible talks about God hating as well in the Old Testament. I could go on with that. But I want to say that there is a right way to hate. A right way to hate. If this was on YouTube, and which it is, praise God. But if this went viral, people would say, what do you mean a right way to hate? You shouldn't hate anybody. This is why Christians are horrible. Because they believe in the Bible that says hatred is okay. Are you hearing me? And at the end of the day, I can have a million people in front of me yelling at me. So I say, yes, absolutely right. I stand with the word of God. Come at me. Take me out. I know where I'm going. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? So here, the Bible calls us to hate sinful people. In other words, not to merely chill in sin with people, but to be the one who would lead them to become a saint. We shouldn't want to quickly run to our old friends and old ways. Why? Because they need to see what a Christian's like. If you're not strong enough, they won't see nothing. In other words, you go there with the purpose of bringing holiness to a situation. This is why the Bible talks about the church and how there's certain people in sin in the church, and the Bible actually says have nothing to do with them. He's talking about those who were doing sexually immoral things. He said don't even sit with them. Are you hearing me? He's talking to the church.
Right.
Because it's the same God here and the same God there.
Yeah.
New Testament, principle of the church and Christianity and community, and same one here. Person with good character doesn't merely want to just wallow in sin. In other words, where sin is all around, they're just like, oh, cool, I won't drink. I'm just here, just kind of hanging out. Oh, there's a stripper, but that's all right. The Lord's guarding my mind. Are you hearing me? Come on, I don't know what kind of friends you had. Amen. I don't know what you came from. Bottom line is, we think we can let things live when God has called them to die. So don't sit around sinners without reason. And look what it says. It says, honor those who have respect for the Lord. Amen. Honor those who have respect for the Lord. It doesn't just say honor everyone who says they know the Lord. It says those who respect the Lord. Those who revere the Lord. Or other versions says those who fear the Lord. Amen. Honor those. Like, man, this person fears God. Praise God. Let's connect. Hey, this person's awesome, man. They're... It's not about how many times they read the Bible. It's just the Bible comes out of their mouth all the time. Amen. I've always laughed at that when somebody says, I read the Bible all day and night. I want to hear somebody speak the Bible all day and night. Amen. That's just me, though. That's just me. And so, don't badmouth, number three, or try to get back. And number four, don't sit around sinners without reason. And now, stand with those who fear the Lord. He keeps, now this is another good character trait, and I guess we're about to end soon. He keeps his promises even when it hurts. God is serious when you say something. He's serious. He says life and death is at the tip, in the mouth, on your tongue. Life and death. That means you can speak a thing, and it's not that all of a sudden it's going to happen, alakazam. I'm telling you that God has given you words, and the Bible says in very clearly, He will judge every idle word that has come out of some of our mouths. Are you hearing me? An idle word is something that doesn't profit anybody. It just comes out and it doesn't do anything. It just sits there, takes up space. God's called us to speak life. Now, we have got to keep our promises. The reason why we say things and the reason why we're held to this standard is because if we want to be more like God, we've got to act like Him. When God says something, He doesn't go back on it. His mercy in Nineveh in the Old Testament is not a picture of Him moving based on human reaction. And I'm bringing this up just in case some of you are thinking that. God says something and He means it. He designed it in a way to bring salvation about. In Nineveh in the Old Testament. And when God speaks, He doesn't retract what He says. So He calls us to not be like Him in the sense that we are blameless completely in this and we're flawless. David wasn't. But we're called to be aware of what we say. And when we say it, we've got to keep it, even if it hurts. Are you hearing me? That's almost like, let's say Gladys offered Alyssa on her next paycheck. And Gladys goes to Alyssa and says, you know what? I see that you needed some, I don't know, some bills paid. And I feel like God put it on my heart to help you. And I'm going to give you that next paycheck. All of a sudden, Gladys is hit with some fees, that next paycheck. And Alyssa's all like, Lord, thank you, my time has come. The harvest is nigh. And Gladys has to break it because she shouldn't have made the promise. She shouldn't have said anything. We're called to say things and mean it. Because you know why? Because the devil does the opposite. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? He tried to tempt Jesus while He was fasting and said, I'm going to give you this, that, and the other. I bet my bottom dollar He wouldn't have gave Him nothing. Do you remember? Jesus told Him, if you do this, everything's yours. He tells you, hey, just give into this woman or this relationship or this man, and all of a sudden, everything's going to be great. Just one night, you're going to feel so great. All of a sudden, it's a lifetime of regret, or you end up with some disease. Hello, somebody. The devil sells you things, but he doesn't mean or intend to bless you based on what he's saying. But God's called his children to be different. And when we say something, we stand by it. It's one thing to make a mistake, you know, when you say something and you kind of, it slips your mind. Do you see the difference? Are you hearing me? There's a godly expectation and an ungodly expectation. Where, you know, I'll say, honey, I'm going to clean the dishes tomorrow. And then I forget, and all of a sudden the judgment of the Lord is heaps upon me because I did not clean the dishes the way that I said. But I got to be careful next time, because I've got to know if I say it, I've got to do it. Amen? Amen. This is good. This is really good. Praise God. We only got six and seven, number six and number seven. So let's go to number five, verse five. He lends his money without charging too much interest. In other words, when you see a need, you meet a need. And you're not trying to get something out of it. This is not merely just giving to the homeless. It's giving to people who do have homes, who just are in some binds, who are next to you in church or in your life. Are you hearing me? He lends his money without charging too much interest. In other words, you could charge interest. Now, if we were using another scripture, simply it wouldn't say anything about interest. But here there's a leeway in what David's saying here. So he doesn't accept money to harm those who aren't guilty. Anyone who lives like that will always be secure. We're called to look to meet the benefit, or rather meet the needs of someone else for the benefit of someone else and not our own. We're called to do that. See a need and meet the need. We're called to use our finances wisely as well, in a way that is, again, not lacking integrity, because all of these things point to someone who has integrity. In our hearts, we can think so many things, but we've got to take it out of our heart if it's starting to form roots. For some of us here, again, you look okay on the outside, but inside, your heart has so many roots of just bitterness, anger, envy, malice against people. You're telling the lie about people, even things you don't even know, you're speaking it. Things that you do know, you're speaking it, but you shouldn't. Are you hearing me? There's roots growing in your heart where it's like, it's defiling what God's trying to do. God desires, again, to use every circumstance for the benefit of his children. But it's going to burn to get things out of you. Imperfections and flaws. It's going to burn. It has to sting. It has to hit you if it's real. This is why. In Proverbs 17, verse 3, it says, the crucible is for silver, and the furnace is for gold. And the Lord tests the hearts. The Bible talks about God as being an all-consuming fire. What does that mean? It consumes. It takes up and keeps burning everything that's in it. And we're called to go through the fire. Trials by fire, if you may. And there are things that need to be burnt to be purified. There's things that have to go through the flame to be purified. Our suffering is not in vain, because the Lord is building you up so that you may be tested and approved. And in context with what God's doing here, for the next stage. The next stage of this church, the next stage of your Christian life, the next stage of your business life, the next stage of your life as a wife or as a husband or as a parishioner, that's what you call yourself, a church member, the body of Christ. God wants to build us up, take things out. We're gearing up this season, and we're talking about all these things that are intricate to ourselves and how we can better serve the kingdom of God together and individually.
And again, you can have all the abilities and talents and gifts in the world. You can know all the Bible you can know. But if character is a problem, if your character is bad, again, you can have temporary success or success in the eyes of some men and women here. But in God's eyes, we're not found faithful through the fire. Things come up and we keep failing them and failing them. And it's not that it's because we're not perfect. It's because we can care less to check them off of our lives. We want to live with that bitterness. We want to live with that jealousy. We want to live with that envy. We want to live with that stingy, greedy heart. We want to live with not doing the right thing. We want to live while being deceptive. Are you hearing me? You start living with your sin, you could start naming them. You could start giving them pet names. Are you hearing me? We've spoken harshly of too many people in our lives. And God can't take you too far at all if that's your heart. Your character can be likened to that. What's in your heart tonight, Prevail Church? What does God want to pull out and burn out so that He can use you? So He can restore something new in you that was being blocked because of your own stubbornness. What is it in your heart, in your character, that has kinks, that has holes? I want you to lay that tonight at the feet of Jesus with all of your might, figuratively, spiritually, right now in this place. Where you're seated, I want you to think on the Lord right now. And this set of verses in Psalms 15. We're all found guilty in different things, and we're all by Jesus and faith in Him saved. However, that does not mean you have a free pass to live as you please without being worked on and cut. You will get cut if you're part of the kingdom. You will hurt if you're following Jesus. You will be sad at church to then be made well in the same place. Because God chooses to use circumstances, situations, leadership, peers, mentors. He chooses to use them all to pull things out. Family members that don't even love Jesus, He'll use that to see what comes out of you and to see what you'll do with it. Are you going to respond differently, or are you going to be the same? God wants to refine your character, Prevail. He's preparing us to be that spotless bride He's coming back for. So where you are, I will speak no longer, and I want you to speak to the Lord. You and God, your heart, take advantage of this moment. You know what God's word has done. Just respond to it.